So, you're a passenger seated at the window of a commercial aircraft and you're about to land. You watch as the trees grow larger, cars become bigger, and roads grow wider. Your plane crosses over the airport perimeter fence and the runway suddenly appears under your plane's wing. You grab your armrest in preparation for landing, but the touchdown is so smooth that it's nearly imperceptible. The landing was perfect. Behind the flight deck door, the flying pilot is silently or overtly pleased with their effort. So what might have contributed to making this landing so buttery smooth? Let's explore all the factors in today's video. It stands to reason that weather is a leading influencer of the quality of a landing. Gusty winds, especially those that blow across the runway, typically result in a firmer landing. Passengers seated in the rear of an aircraft will also feel a side-to-side yaw after landing as the pilot uses the rudder to maintain the centerline. Aside from the wind, landing on a wet or icy runway requires pilots to establish firm contact between the tires and the runway's surface to avoid hydroplaning or skidding. Pilots also want to initiate braking as soon as possible under these conditions, so as a result, less effort might be given to a graceful touchdown in exchange for enhanced stopping margins. If there is snow or other freezing precipitation at the airport, pilots have to adjust landing speeds to account for possible ice accumulation. It's important to know that small amounts of ice on a plane can bring substantial aerodynamic penalties. Thus, landing speeds are conservatively increased to maintain a healthy margin above the stall boundary to counter this. The trade-off is that the pilots are handling a faster approach speed onto an already icy or wet runway. In the interest of safety, pilots will primarily focus on putting the plane on the runway. Sorry, passengers, but a smooth landing in these conditions is a bonus. We're sure you'd agree. Next up, an aircraft's approach speed, the runway length, and the flap setting used for landing go hand in hand to determine whether a touchdown is rough or smooth. A short runway requires special consideration. Most airlines identify short runway airports and use enhanced metrics to determine the landing distances. One of the stipulations of landing at a short runway airport, usually less than 7,000 feet available for a narrow-body aircraft, is using a higher degree flap setting. This reduces the approach speed pilots fly at and consequently reduces the landing distance on the runway. An exceedingly short runway might require pilots to land in the first 1,000 feet of the runway. This generally means there won't be as much of a flare before landing, resulting in a firmer touchdown. Could the fact that certain budget airlines service smaller airports with shorter runways be the real reason they've developed a reputation for hard landings? Let us know what you think. Anyways, pilots become accustomed to landing their airplane at a standard flap setting within a predictable speed envelope of plus minus 10 knots. If the plane is heavier, the approach speed increases. The approach speed is significantly less than usual if the aircraft is exceedingly light, such as on a maintenance ferry flight. Flying an empty plane will result in an approach speed of about 15 knots less than pilots are used to, affecting how the aircraft handles on landing. Landing a lighter than usual plane isn't inherently more difficult, pilots just aren't as used to it. The same is true when using higher flap settings on short runways. Higher flap settings lead to a few degrees of attitude difference on approach. Pilots only land a handful of approaches per year at higher than standard flap settings. This slight change in attitude might render the normal muscle memory used for landing insufficient for a smooth touchdown. A high-elevation airport has two main differences compared to its sea-level counterparts. 1. Planes approach the runway at higher speeds and the aircraft handles differently in the flare. Approaching the runway at a higher speed does not mean the plane has a higher airspeed, but rather a faster ground speed. Due to the effects of air density at higher elevations, an aircraft needs to fly faster over the ground to produce the same amount of lift for a given airspeed. An approach speed of 135 knots might result in a landing distance of 4,500 feet in Los Angeles at sea level and 5,500 feet in Denver, which sits at 5,400 feet above sea level. Pilots land at higher elevations with as much runway in front of them as possible, especially on warmer days. 2. The other consideration at high-altitude airports is the aerodynamic differences from reduced air density. Pilots rely on muscle memory to induce a flare at a particular height above the runway. The flare checks the rate of descent and ensures the plane lands with a minimal downward acceleration compared to the standard 750-foot-per-minute vertical approach speed. If a pilot uses the same pitch increase before landing, or flare, in Denver as in Los Angeles, the plane will probably meet the ground at a higher vertical speed than desired. This is because the elevator at the plane's tail is less effective in producing a pitch-up movement in the thinner air. Pilots who land at high-elevation airports regularly understand the pitch amplitude differences needed for a smooth landing. However, pilots who land at these airports less frequently usually struggle to adjust. Next, an aircraft's design characteristics determine how easily pilots can consistently produce a smooth touchdown. All other factors being equal, the gear configuration and ground clearance dictate how pilots can fly their plane through the flare and landing. Take, for example, a Boeing 777. Reported by its pilots to handle nicely on landing, the 777 features two main gear bogies with three rows of two tires. The bogies are angled at a tilt when extended in the air so that the rear row meets the runway before the four remaining tires, thus absorbing and dispersing the vertical acceleration. This gear configuration more easily allows pilots to roll it on or produce a pleasant landing. Most wide-body aircraft feature this type of gear. By comparison, Boeing 737 pilots report more difficulty in producing soft landings. In particular, pilots of the stretched 737-900 variant operate an aircraft that is long, squats to the ground, and requires a relatively high approach speed. The degree to which a 737-900 pilot can flare is more significantly limited by the maximum nose-up attitude before striking the tail. A comparable Airbus A321 has substantially more ground clearance and flies at a slower approach speed for a given weight. This means the pilots have less energy to manage and a greater flare margin with which to manage this energy. The takeaway of our examples? Some planes are more challenging to land softly than others. The best external conditions for a smooth landing are a constant, non-gusting headwind straight down the runway. An ideal runway will be long and dry, and it won't have any buildings near the runway to disrupt the wind as the aircraft approaches the runway. Furthermore, the ideal landing of a plane would not be during icy conditions, and a standard flap configuration would be used. As for the aircraft itself, it would be at an average landing weight, not too heavy, but not too light. The approach speed is within the standard range that the pilots are accustomed to flying. The pilots are experienced on the plane and at the elevation they are landing. Even if every condition for landing is perfect, the human factor is always at play. Every pilot will agree that landings combine skill and environmental factors. Humble pilots will admit that a good landing also requires a touch of luck. If you're able to recall them, we would love to hear about your best and/or worst landings. Just leave them in the comment section down below. Simple Flying publishes over 150 articles every week. If you're looking for the latest aviation news and insights, visit simpleflying.com.